four brothers adjusting the camera, mashallah. That's how much effort we're putting. Alhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa man wala. Brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We're almost at the end of the seerah. We're almost at the end. I would say about five more lessons, inshallah. I intend to finish in about five lessons. I had some of our brothers saying that, mashallah, it's going long. And I'm thinking, okay, well, we can summarize it. And maybe other topics we can discuss. But I think the seerah is very, very, very beneficial in a lot of ways. I don't know, some people see it as a story. And I don't know why they say this. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, the majority do love the seerah, alhamdulillah. And they can extract so many lessons from it. My brothers and sisters in Islam, today inshallah, we are going to talk about the event of Khaybar. If you have heard about the event of Khaybar, then you will know what you're about to witness today. It's quite interesting. And lots of little lessons can be derived from that, from things that the Prophet ﷺ said, from occasions that happened in this event, that we can actually apply to ourselves today, even in our own homes, in our understanding of our religion, with our family, with ourselves, with our neighbors, with our fellow people who we live with, even towards the non-Muslims, especially towards the non-Muslims. I mean, we're living in the West, and this can teach us so much about how to interact with non-Muslims and how to think about what Islam says about these things. My brothers and sisters in Islam, last week we spoke about the Treaty of the Hudaybiyah, and that treaty is with, to which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, Inna fatahna laka fatham mubina. We have now opened for you a great opening. One would think that when you hear we have opened for you a great opening or a victory, you would think that a battle occurred, killing occurred, fighting occurred when you say we have opened for you a great victory. But really, this verse is only talking about an agreement of truce, a peace treaty, that we will not fight anymore. The enemies now have been, 13 years the Prophet ﷺ is in Mecca, then another 6 years in Medina. What's that?
19.
Do the maths, 19 years. 19 years of enmity. And this is the first time Allah says, we have now given you an opening victory. Not in the battle of Badr, not in the battle of Uhud, not in the battle of the trenches. Now, what is the opening of victory? This peace treaty they made with that enemy. What is the peace treaty? It looks like the Muslims have been stepped on. Literally, stepped on. It looks like the Muslims have been humiliated by this peace treaty. How? Because it said, any Muslim, any person from us who embraces Islam, you can't take them, you have to return them back. We'll punish them, we'll torture them, we'll do whatever we want with them. And anyone who leaves Islam, you have to let them come back. And you can't do your Umrah this year, you have to do it next year, so no one can think that you had the upper hand against us. We want to still look like we are strong. And the Prophet gave him that. You know, he gave him that. He didn't care if people think they're glorious or whatever. This is not a fight of reputation, who's got more glory. The Prophet ﷺ is a messenger of God. He's way beyond that. He is using super rational approaches. Super rational. There's rational, there's irrational, and there's super rational. Beyond us. Higher purpose. The thing about the peace treaty was not those other three I mentioned. They were about the 10 years when both parties agreed that neither will attack the other. Brothers and sisters, this is the best agreement anyone can make. You can use this even with somebody who you are having problems with. There's enmity between you and your brother, you and your sister, you and your families, you and your neighbor, you and your fellow citizen, you and at work, anybody. If there's a long ongoing enmity or fight between you two, and then suddenly there's a chance for you two to come to a truce and agree that, you know, look, let's just respect each other and not harm each other. It's the best kind of agreement. Move on. Don't keep, you know, holding grudges and wanting revenge. I think this is the greatest lesson, because Prophet ﷺ had gone through what he had gone through. They tried to assassinate him, tried to kill his family, tried to kill all the Muslims, and in the end, he still wants this agreement. Why? 10 years is an opportunity for the Muslims to do what? What is the most powerful weapon the Muslims have? Given the opportunity to teach our religion to others. The word is da'wah, and the word da'wah does not mean converting, foreseeing. It means inviting. Inviting. You have a wedding, for example, and you send the card to invite people, right? What do you put? You put RSVP by this date. And you invite them. They can accept or refuse. Isn't that correct? No dramas. So Allah called it ud'u ila sabili rabbika bil hikmati wal maw'idati al hasana. Call to the path of your Lord. That's your mission. With wisdom, bil hikmah. This is the wisdom here. 10 years of peace. Nobody's going to bother us. Nobody's going to be afraid. We can talk now. We can talk. We can listen. They can listen. We don't have to fear that our security is gone. بِالْحِكْمَةِ وَالْمَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. And when you speak to people, or write to people, or communicate with people, or deal with people, you want to show them your deen? There are hundreds of ways you can show them your deen. But do it with the best مَوْعِظَةِ, with the best way that you can approach them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not specify the way in the Qur'an. He just said مَوْعِظَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ. The only thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala cautioned the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from using is فَضَّ غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ. Not being harsh in his approach and not being harsh-hearted towards people, like talking with hatred or talking with stress or talking with enmity or ego or judgmentality, harshness. You should do this and you don't do that, and judging people and saying all sorts of things as though someone's going to hell for you. No, you have to have wisdom and a goodly approach. That's all. And so, my brothers and sisters in Islam, now comes the real purpose of the Prophet's mission, da'wah, calling people to the deen. And now you're going to see from here on, there is one more battle, about three more battles, but one more, which is against the Jews. The Jews of Khaybar. Khaybar is a place about nearly 200 kilometers away from Medina. This battle had to happen. And even in these battles, you will realize that the Prophet ﷺ seizes any opportunity to still give da'wah, to still invite, to still teach, even to the enemy, an open enemy who's got arms opened against him. Still use the opportunity. The war and battle should not stop you from using the opportunity to still give people the chance to learn the deen of Allah. However, brothers and sisters, calling to the deen of Allah requires that your security be ensured. Is that correct? No one can survive without breathing. Give them breathing. Then no one can survive without drinking. You've got to give them water. No one can survive without eating. You've got to give them their food. No one can survive without security. Their lives, their property, their honor, their dignity has to be protected. Then people can start interacting, communicating, living in harmony, not being afraid of any harm or danger upon them. No inciting of wars or enmity or harm upon anyone. Not the Muslims, nor those who are non-Muslim. None of them. This is the beautiful platform that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves for everybody. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, in Surah Al-Ma'idah, Al-Imran, Surah Al-Baqarah, about the people of the book, for example, the Christians and the Jews, He used to say to them, He told us in the Quran, when we speak to the children of the book, the Jews and the Christians, and others even, because they were the majority, they were the main focus, they shared a common sort of common faith with us, some of the common faith, some of the things, such as some of the prophets that we believe in, some of the scriptures that Allah sent down. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, speak with them. Speak with them with wisdom. Give and take. وَجَادِلْهُمْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. And dialogue with them, discuss with them in that which is the best manner. And if you're going to invite people, then you're going to expect to also listen to what they have to say. Isn't that correct? Am I right or wrong? Don't you have to listen to someone if you're going to invite them? If you're going to tell them to listen, then you have to also listen. You can't shove deen down people's throats. You have to listen. And you have to acknowledge if they're right about something, don't be afraid to tell them, you know, you've got a point. You've got a point. I see where you're coming from. And that's how the Prophet ﷺ used to do. He used to listen even to even the things that were so stupid, so pathetic. But he would listen. Until every person has a dignity. They want to feel that they are somewhat important. Even if what they say is stupid. There's no need for you to say, that's stupid. We don't patronize people. We don't put people down. Remember, if you're inviting, then you can't use your personal vendetta. You can't use your personal emotions in this. Right? Allah said in the Quran, when things go wrong, وَإِذَا خَاطَبَهُمُ الْجَاهِلُونَ قَالُوا سَلَامٌ. And when the ignorant address them, they say, peace, peace. Sometimes some people, they know what they're saying is wrong, but they just want to bully, they just want to manipulate, they just want to misinform, they just want to destroy, they have an agenda. Sometimes these people, talking to them doesn't work. You have to just avoid them and use other strategies. For example, sometimes we hear the media or politicians working against the Muslims, and some of them scapegoat in, circumstances and opportunities, such as what happened now. We all know about the Bourke Street incident, for example, with that brother who attacked the police and the people in the street. No Muslim, no Islam accepts that act. They all know that. The Prime Minister of Australia knows that. He says that he has interacted with Muslims. He says he's interacted with the imams. So I'm sure he knows that Islam does not call to anything like that. No religion says that, actually, to be honest. To be honest with you, no religion says go out into the streets and do terror. But the difference is, we Muslims, Allah told us to be fair and just. Terror is terror. It's got nothing to do with religion. If people use religion in order to incite terrorism, then these people are the ones who are doing a criminal act. Sometimes we use, lots of people use different things. They use family, they use their ego, they use money, they use religion in order to cause war. And the majority of wars in the world start off because of oppression. And that oppression turns into nationalism. And then to make the war keep going, they bring religion into it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did say in the Quran, اشتروا بآيات الله ثمنا قليلا. Talks about the people who disbelieved in Allah. Some of them used the religion to their advantage. Allah says, they used the verses of Allah as a currency to buy things according to their agenda. They used the religion to purchase evil with it. And this is one of the biggest disbeliefs in Islam, no matter if you call yourself Muslim or not. Some people have mental illnesses. Some people, but no, when it comes to Muslims, these people just want to attack. What's important is that our word stays one. One of the beautiful things, I like focusing on the positives, is that alhamdulillah, for the first time I see, personally, this year, I see that with social media and all that, Muslims are uniting closer to one kind of word. I see the imams are talking closer to one agreement. I'm not saying everything's perfect. There's a lot of work to do. There's still lots of mistakes. There's still a bit of fear. There's still a bit of some people may be a little bit hypocritical. Some people may be very sincere. Others, everyone in between. But for the first time that I see, the objective should be so we can work to have one word. One word, like one body, Prophet ﷺ did say all the time, Al-Muslimu lil Muslim kal-bunyan. A Muslim to another Muslim is like a building. Yashuddu ba'duhu ba'da. Each brick in the building supports the other brick. The Prophet ﷺ said, support your brother if he is the oppressor or the oppressed. They said, Ya Rasulullah, we know how to support him if he's the one being oppressed, being wronged, being attacked. But how do we support him if he's the attacker, he's the perpetrator? SubhanAllah, the Prophet ﷺ did not distinguish between the act. Sorry, the Prophet ﷺ distinguished between the act and the religion. He said, a person can be a Muslim. He called him your brother from your community. But if he is the oppressor, he said, go to your brother and support him by stopping him from doing his act of oppression. Stopping him, helping him to stop. So we have to help each other to stop. When they find that we have one word and we are together, even if we have some differences, but we're together on one word, and what benefits the community, people start to see strength in that community. That strength in the community, that one word. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about the Jews in the Quran, تَحْسَبُهُمْ جَمِيعًا وَقُلُوبُهُمْ شَتَّى. When you look at them from outside, you assume, you can see, you're almost convinced that they are one. They have one word. And it's true, even till today here in Australia, something comes out about the Jews, they have one spokesperson to represent. As for all the issues, well, they live in between each other. Allah says, وَقُلُوبُهُمْ شَتَّى, but mark my words, they are very divided among each other. They accuse each other and betray each other. But on the outside, when it comes to their survival, one word. Yeah, the majority of them. Except for the Zionists, they oppose all the Jews of the world. However, my brothers and sisters, we live in a world where our survival and our dignity is reliant on us supporting one another, on us having one word. You know, in your family, if you disagree, there's a fight between your family, dysfunctional family. The last thing you should do is let others know this. What you should be doing is keeping a fortress. Don't let anybody in to be involved in your family issues. Otherwise it gets bigger. And then it's easier to solve it. You talk between each other, but on the outside, appear as a family. Because you don't want to involve other people who've probably got jealousy, envy, hatred. I also give this on a side note. On social media, no need to show your family stuff on there. There's jealous people, there's envious people, and unfortunately we're still humans. But when we have one word together, alhamdulillah, we're able to move forward, inshaAllah ta'ala. Even if that one word is not entirely the best. Okay? We don't live in a situation where we're able to bring out the best word. There's always something better. There's always better opinions. But as the Prophet Allah says in the Quran, فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Make a decision and then rely on Allah. Do something. But the first time I see, inshallah, on a positive note, personally, maybe you disagree with me, I see that we have a more of an agreement in what we're saying. And our words are being heard, alhamdulillah. They're getting there. So lots of brothers, lots of sisters, lots of people coming out with these new videos and coming out on social media and talking. And it seems like we're going almost on the same line. Almost on the same line. Okay? Needs a bit of refinement, but it's almost on the same line. We all know what the trick is. We all know what the politics are. We all know what's happening. We all know this. Right? We know this. We know that it's an opportunity for people who have an agenda to use this in order to support their agenda and to play with people's minds and use the media to manipulate minds and so on and so forth. Okay? My brothers and sisters, that's all I wanted to say about that. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam only wanted a clear ground. He wanted an open ground. To do what? To teach the deen which Allah sent him with. قُمْ فَأَنذِرْ. Get up and warn the people. And teach the people. Give hope to the people. Teach the people and warn the people. That's the mission of the Prophet ﷺ. Isn't that correct? So now we have 10 years of peace. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went back to Medina. And in Medina, it was only the first or second day. A Sahabi, a companion, who had just embraced Islam in Mecca, came to the Prophet. He didn't know about the agreements that the Muslims had. So he comes to Medina, says, Ya Rasulullah, I embraced Islam, take me in. The Prophet and then two other men from the Quraysh had come chasing him. So Ya Rasulullah, they enter, they say, Ya Muhammad, you know the agreement? If anyone becomes Muslim, you've got to return them back to us. And here's something very important to learn. Rasulullah, what did he do? He didn't say, he's now with me in Medina, let him go. He didn't abduct them and betray them. No. He said, true. They grabbed the companion, the Muslims grabbed the companion, and forced to give him over. Ya Rasulullah, they'll make me a kafir, they'll torture me, they'll take me out of my deen. I'll die in that. Rasulullah said, Al-mu'minu wa anda shurutih. Believers stick to their agreements. He said, don't worry, I say to you what I said to Abu Janda, Allah will give you victory, Allah will help you. And that's when the man said, okay, I understand. There's an agreement. Rasulullah ﷺ, the Messenger of God, does not break his agreements. So he went with these two men, and Umar radiallahu anhu, now this guy, Umar radiallahu anhu, you're going to hear about it a few times here. He really interests me, which makes you really laugh. He's very vocal, he's very straight, and he's just very blunt, you know? So you would expect something like this with him. He goes and after the man in secret, and as he's walking beside him, he just points. He points to his sword. He points to the man's sword in his pocket. Just go. What is he saying? Use your sword against them. Get yourself out of this. Kill them. Don't let them take you back. Why didn't Umar radiallahu anhu grab the sword himself and kill them? Because Umar radiallahu anhu is an ally of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And whatever the Prophet ﷺ agrees to, all those who are allies with him are also part of the agreement. So nobody's allowed to break the agreement. The Sahabi said, okay, good. So as he went a little bit of a distance, Sahabi managed to fight these men and kill them. And what did he do? He didn't return back to Mecca, and he didn't return back to Medina. No, he did return back to Medina, said, Ya Rasul, he got saw the blood on him and everything. Rasulullah looked at him, he says, what happened? He said, I killed them, Ya Rasulullah. Now can you take me? He said, I can't. Your action is not mine, I can't. I can't break the agreement. This will be treachery. You're on your own. The man said, all right, I understand. I'll take care of myself. He said, you didn't do it. And you returned me, you did what you promised. But I did this myself, so you're not responsible, and no one has done anything. This is my work. I don't belong to you, and I don't belong to them. I just ran away, used my brain. But Rasulullah ﷺ smiled, and he said, well, you can't stay here, because that means that I'm protecting you. You got to leave. SubhanAllah, look how intricate Rasulullah ﷺ is following the agreement to detail. As the Sahabi left, he reached a distance. The Prophet ﷺ looks at him, and the Sahabas heard the Prophet ﷺ say this. He said, like, what means like this? What some words I can think of, sort of like in our modern day terms would be, you know, like in very simple words, young teenagers would say, you know, what a sick dude, you know, something like that. But he said it in a more respectful way. The Prophet ﷺ says, what a strong man, what a warrior, what a beast, what a sick beast, in other words, you know, what a monster. This guy, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him strength and power, if he only had a bunch of men who would fight with him, he would take over Makkah, all of it, just by himself. So he heard this, but he didn't respond, and he went and sat in a little mountain outside of Medina, a few about 50 kilometers away. And the people of Mecca, the news reached there that this guy, he did something smart, and no one can blame the Prophet. So now everybody who started to embrace Islam, where did they go? To this Sahabi. I'm trying to remember his name. Abu Basir. No? Abu Basir. Abu Basir. Hafidhat Allah. If you know the Seerah, why are you coming here? I'm joking. I'm glad that you're using him correctly. Abu Basir, radiallahu anhu. The first one to follow him was Abu Janda. Yalla test. Abu Janda. Abu Janda. Abu Janda, remember the first one who was returned. Last week I said he was returned. Abu Janda, he goes, aha, Abu Wasir, I should have thought about it myself. So he goes and joins him in the mountain. And the people started to gather, and now there was this, almost this other Muslim nation gathering in the mountain. In today's terms, you call them guerrilla warfare. These people hid in the mountains, and no, how are you going to get them? They're hiding in caves and in trees and things like that. The Meccans found out about it. So what did they do? Abu Basir had gathered close to maybe 1,000 people now. And the Meccans, not even, maybe a couple of hundred, I'm sorry, I exaggerate. So the Meccans sent their soldiers to them to try and... Because what were they doing? Not only were they in the mountains, but they were also stopping all the Meccan caravans that were going to do trade in Syria. So they're stopping all the trade. Mecca's going to suffocate if these guys keep doing that. And they can't blame the Prophet ﷺ, because the Prophet ﷺ stuck to his agreement. What can he do? So they went to the mountains to try and annihilate these guerrilla people. And they couldn't. They were beating them each time they sent forces. They beat them, they killed them. Because he can't fight an unorganized army. Who are they? They're not an army, they're not soldiers. Just people from trees and caves jumping on us. So the Meccans, they got scared. They started really concerned. Well, we can't do trade, we're going to be cut off from resources. Mecca's, it's a dry desert. We need to go to Sham. These people are going to let us go. So subhanAllah, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's wisdom works. From that treaty, Hudaybiyah, subhanAllah, the kuffar thought that they are making an agreement that befits them, but it was actually to their detriment. That statement, anyone who embraces Islam can't go back to you, is now working against them. So Abu Sufyan comes to the Prophet ﷺ, the leader of Mecca, and he says, Ya Rasulullah, didn't write it, he went to him personally, Ya Muhammad, look, I know we agreed, but this agreement of people becoming Muslim, not going to, we want to take that out. Please take it out. It's causing us harm. And the Prophet ﷺ laughed. He said, subhanAllah, how things work, huh? And so that agreement was gone. Now, anyone who embraces Islam can go to the Muslims. But anyone who leaves Islam can go to Mecca. Umar said, why? The Prophet ﷺ said, those who don't want Islam are of no benefit to us. They're of more harm to us. Let them go. But those who want to become Muslim, they come and live with us. And so, subhanAllah, this is how that part of the treaty was broken. And my dear brothers and sisters, subhanAllah, it is much easier when the opponent, when you let the opponent make a particular decision and then it works against them, it's much better and you are more victorious when they make the decision and it works against them, subhanAllah. Sometimes you hear people that argue with you and you think, it's just so stupid. What you're saying is gonna, you're just digging your hole deeper. There's no need for you to say to them you're digging your hole deeper. Just nod your head and say, okay. Well, that's your opinion. I respect your opinion. Just do what you want. And just watch them fall. My brothers and sisters in Islam, stay calm. Stay civil. No need to get angry. Anger will make you go lost. And these people came back to the Prophet ﷺ and joined the Messenger ﷺ. SubhanAllah, how the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala works. So whoever's with Allah and goes on the guidance of Allah, even if it seems like you're failing, Allah is with you. In tansurullah yansurkum. If you give Allah victory, Allah will give you victory. And here you look at the Prophet ﷺ sticking to his agreement, which is unfair. But it was the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that makes that unfair agreement the path of Allah. And that means give victory to Allah. Support your messenger, even if you think his agreement is unfair. Support your brothers and sisters, even if you think they have faults. It doesn't matter. Work together. Work towards what's best for your community, for your ummah. My brothers and sisters in Islam, and so this opened the door for more people to embrace Islam. Among them was Khalid ibn Walid, radiallahu anhu. You see, what this did was that a lot of people were allowed now to go to Medina, listen to Islam, listen to the Prophet ﷺ, embrace Islam and stay there. And they're allowed to bring their wealth with them and so on. But guess what? Not even 10 days had passed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to go and fight the Jews of Khaybar. This was an order by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Well, because The Jews of Khaybar, remember, there was one of those tribes that was called Bani Nadir. They were the neighbors of the Prophet ﷺ. Remember that one? They were the neighbors. And they had done treachery and tried to assassinate the Prophet ﷺ and tried to entice treachery and war. So the Prophet ﷺ gave them the option of leaving. So they left. When they left, they started inciting all the other Arab tribes to gather against the Prophet ﷺ because they want to reclaim Medina. So they went and joined their other cousins, other people, in a place called Khaybar. That had been inhabited by Jews who had come from Yemen, far place, and somehow they ended up in the Arab lands, and they just settled there. It wasn't their land, but they just somehow came over time and settled there. And they learned the Arabic language, they used to speak Aramaic, which became Hebrew, and they also spoke Arabic, acted like Arabs, but they weren't real originally Arabs. They were children of Israel from Harun and Musa's time, alayhi salam. These people in Khaybar, they had fortresses, forts. Allahu alam how many, I think about 9 forts. And this land Khaybar was full of vegetation, more palm trees than any place in all of Arabia. Full of abundance of water and vegetation and crops and gold and silver and resources that you can ever imagine. It was inhabited by these 9 forts, and each group of Jews had their own forts. They used to guard those forts. They were high on cliffs. Some of them were much higher with their walls of fortresses. You've watched films before about ancient Rome and stuff like that, and you've watched, you know, about the Byzantines and in Britain and Great Britain, all that. You see the big fortresses and castles. Well, these castles, this is how the Jews had them. So the Prophet ﷺ knew that these Jews of Khaybar are preparing to attack the Prophet ﷺ. And they were not allies of the Meccans. And they were not allies of the Muslims either. And they have refused to make any peace treaty with the Prophet ﷺ. So now they are an open threat. They are an open threat. Especially that they had broken the agreement with the Prophet ﷺ beforehand in the Battle of the Trenches, and had tried to incite war and killing of them, so it wasn't over. He had to deal with the Jews of Khaybar. Not because they were Jews, coincidentally they were Jews, but because of their act. Rasulullah ﷺ always separated between the act and the religion, the act and the race, the act and the gender, the act and the color, or anything you were. It didn't matter. Rasulullah ﷺ once stood up to show you his justice. And he said, Wallahi, if Fatima, my daughter, Fatima radiallahu anha, Fatima al-Zahra, one of the 4 perfect women of the world, promised paradise. Rasulullah said, Wallahi, by the ladhi nafsi biyadi, by the one who possesses my soul, if my daughter Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were to steal enough for the rule of severing her hand, cutting her hand off, would apply to her, Wallahi, I would cut her hand off. Wallahi, he said it in open. So Rasulullah ﷺ is not picking and choosing, he's not an opportunist, he's not a terrorist, he's none of these things. He's a just messenger of God. And his actions prove it. So now he's going to these people, the Jews of Khaybar, who are now still a threat, and they are preparing, and they have not made a peace treaty. He had to go and deal. And by the way, brothers and sisters, that's how the world was in those days. It's not like today. Everybody was open to attack anyone. That was the rule of the entire world, from all over Persia to Rome, to the Arabs, to the Jews, everyone. Anyone can attack another tribe. Anyone can attack another nation, unless they are allies. It was like a jungle. The strong consume the weak. These Jews had nothing. So Prophet had to go and deal with them. What did he do? Do you remember last week I told you that a group of Muslims, of the companions, they went with the Prophet to Umrah and they did the Treaty of Hudaybiyah with him? Who remembers their number? 1,000? About 1,000? 1,400 approximately. Or 1,500. They are called Ahlul Shajar, the people of the tree. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned them in the Quran, لَقَدْ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ يُبَايِعُونَكَ تَحْتَ الشَّجَرَةِ. Allah has become pleased and bestows pleasure upon those who pledge allegiance with you, a messenger of God, under the tree. فَعَلِمَ مَا فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ. He knew what is in their hearts. They were sincere, loyal, forgave them and made them the elites. Nobody was equal to them anymore. This pledge is called Bay'atul Ridwan, the pledge of the pleasure of Allah. Only the people who pledged allegiance in Hudaybiyah were allowed to go with the Prophet ﷺ to fight the Jews of Khaybar. No one else was allowed. But guess what? The hypocrites came out. The weak Muslims who didn't take part, they came out. What do they want? They said, we want to go with you on jihad, Ya Rasulullah. We want to fight with you for the sake of God. We want to fight the enemy who attack us. We want to protect you, Ya Rasulullah. The Prophet ﷺ knew Khaybar is full of wealth. And these people didn't come out except because there was wealth. Where were they in Badr? Where were they in Uhud? Where were they in the treaty of the trenches? Where were they in Hudaybiyah now? Where were they? So the Prophet ﷺ said to them, okay, listen, if you want to go with me on jihad, you want to fight the enemy for the sake of Allah, then go, but on one condition. You are not allowed to share any of the spoils of the war. You're not going to get anything. No pay, no money. If you want the pleasure of Allah, I told you, you don't have to go. I don't want you to go. And subhanAllah, 90% of them, or more, nearly all of them, ended up finding excuses and they didn't go. And they were left with approximately 1,500, or maybe a little bit more, 1,600. Majority of them, if not maybe 50 or some of them were not, all of them were from the Hudaybiyah Treaty. The best of the men, the best of them. Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Zubayr, Abu Ubaid ibn Jarrah, every one of them is Zayd ibn Haritha, Sa'd ibn Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, Abu Dharr, Hudayf, all of them, all the famous Sahabas that you hear about, brothers and sisters. They went with the Prophet. Now the Prophet had said to them, Allah has promised us Khaybar. So it was a 100% victory. So on their way, the Muslims were so full of enthusiasm and they were so excited. What did they start doing in the valleys? They started to chant and raise their voices. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Nasara wa'ada, Allah is going to give us victory. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They started raising their voices really high. And the Prophet ﷺ calmed them down. He's teaching us how to be. He said, Innakum la tunaduna ba'idan wa la asan. Take it easy. You are not calling to someone who is deaf. You're not calling to someone who is far away from you. Allah is close and near with you all the way. You don't need to call out, you don't need to raise your voice. And this from a fiqh perspective, when you make dua, it is from the sunnah to keep your voice low. Isn't Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala closer to you than your own jugular vein? Allah says, وَهُوَ مَعَكُمْ أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُمْ. He is with you wherever you are. وَنَحْنُ أَقْرَبُ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ حَبْلِ الْوَرِيدِ. We are closer to you than the jugular vein. وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي. If my servants ask you about me, my worshippers, فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. Behold, I am always close. أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِي. I respond to any of the dua that a person does. فَلْيَسْتَجِبْ. Let them always make dua, always close. And the Sahabas now learnt. See, look, amazing. Even on battle, even when their lives are at stake, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still focusing on his main mission. What is it? Teaching the deen, teaching Allah's Quran, making invitation to Islam, saving the people from the fire, making it into Jannah. That's his only mission, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But these coincidental battles had to happen in order to establish security, as we said. As they were going on the way, the Sahabas, they were very happy. For the first time, every single Sahabi had a camel to ride on. Well, they put two on a camel, but they all had camels. And they had approximately 200 horsemen. This is the first time. It's like saying you got 200 fighter jets. 200 fighter jets. And approximately 1,300 tanks and missiles. This is what it looked like, right? So this was the biggest army the Prophet have ever had with the greatest artillery. But Rasulullah is telling them, lower your voices, Allah is close to you, don't forget who you are. It's not because of artillery or numbers that you're... And they knew Allah had promised, so therefore they have no doubt. On their way, something really beautiful happened. The Sahabas, they started saying, Ya Rasulullah, when are we going to get there? Hurry up, let's move, let's move. And the Prophet ﷺ said, one condition, Nobody, under any circumstance, is allowed to beat us ahead. You all stay behind me, behind the Messenger of Allah. It was forbidden for anyone to race ahead. Until one Sahabi, he raced a little bit ahead, and the Prophet got angry at him. Well, he, not angry as in anger, he just got displeased with him. He brought him back, and he said, a person doesn't enter paradise who disobeys the Messenger of Allah. Why are you racing ahead? We don't want the same issue as Uhud, where the Sahabas disobeyed the Prophet and the archers. Don't do that. When you disobey the Messenger of Allah, Allah stays away from you, doesn't give you victory. Swerve off the path. So the man said, Ya Rasulullah, my horse is a very fast horse. I couldn't stop it, it was just keep going. But really, the Sahaba was more enthusiastic. He didn't really lie, but he didn't really tell the whole truth. So Rasulullah said, you stay behind me. Obey your Messenger. And he did. So Rasulullah, one word, kept all in line. They're going to face, you know how many they're going to face? 11,000 Jewish soldiers. And then they're going to be reinforced with 4,000 Arab soldiers. They're called Ghatafan. Their leader, his name is Uyayna. His leader, Uyayna, was a very foolish leader. He was quite stupid. Actually, his people used to call him foolish and stupid. But unfortunately, they were cursed with his leadership. And the Arabs used to say, he has never led us to anything that was successful. He was a stupid man. And what he did was, he agreed with the Jews, he goes, we'll come and support you. And the Jews said, thank you, Ghatafan, big tribe. They weren't allies with anyone. So Uyayna, this leader, brings 4,000 soldiers, and the Prophet ﷺ hears about it. So he sends news to him, go back, you have no business with us, Allah has promised me khayr. Uyayna sends back and says, get out of here. What, you can beat Khaybar, big forts? Rasulullah went back. Ya Uyayna, think with your brain. Allah's promise, you know that I don't say a lie. Go back. Wallahi, you know that you're going to lose. If you lose, you're going to be in trouble. You know, I will not go back. Rasulullah started seeing this is a problem. Sure, if they enter the forts, they're going to attack him from the back. This is a problem. He still has to do what he can. Listen, brothers and sisters, very important point. You know this idea of tawakkul, relying on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some of us, we think, I'm just relying on Allah, Allah promised me. What about you? Do you have to do something? Do you think Allah just says to you, go, I'm with you, and I'll just give you whatever you want, you don't have to do anything? Do you think Allah created us in this world just so they can give us everything? It doesn't happen that way. Even Maryam alayhi salam, Maryam, Mary, the mother of Jesus alayhi salam, peace be upon him. When she was pregnant, she's in labor, she's in pains of labor. We all know what labor is. By herself, near a dry palm tree. And the angel still said to her, وَهُزِّنِ إِلَيْكِ بِجِبْرَيْلِ أَخْرَ. Or maybe Isa alayhi salam, I'm not sure. So one of them said, still, you've got to shake the trunk of the palm tree. This is a woman in labor now. And she's got to shake the trunk of a palm tree. It needs two elephants to do it. And it's a dry tree, it's got no dates. So the dates will fall. You just do what you can. And she just put her hand on the palm tree, just touched it, and the dates fell. Yeah? You know the story? So, tawakkul means you do what you can within your power, and the rest is up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Rasulullah Azam has promised khayr, but still he has to try and do what he has. He's saying, Uyayna, stay away. In the end, there's threats. Then he said to him, Ya Uyayna, when we're victorious, I'm going to give you a quarter of all the palm produce. Uyayna says, get out of here, you're not going to take anything. No, I don't agree. The Prophet said, we'll give you half. A whole year, we'll give you half. Every year. He says, no, I don't want any of your half. This big gold and silver there, you can't do anything about it. And Uyayna goes and puts a leader on the people for those soldiers, and he goes into the fortress himself. The Prophet knew, this is serious, man. This guy's not going to back off. Suddenly, the soldiers who were at the back, the Kafir ones, the Arab ones, they heard someone call out from behind them. Quick! Your women, your children, your village, it's attacked, they're gone, they're going to be killed. Everybody heard this, they started sending the news among each other, and they left the grounds and went back to their house. Sure, family, we've got to go protect our wives and children. When they got there, Uyayna heard about it, he also left the fort and went with them. When they got there, there was nothing. And that's like, we're talking about 200 kilometers away, they can't come all the way back anymore. And what happened? No one knew where this voice came from. Till today, there's no books of Seerah tells us where it came from. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew about it. Jibreel alayhi sallam had told him, Amunadi sarakh, someone called out with his voice, and it was false. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with them. You realize, brothers and sisters, the miracles are happening, but what is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing? He's still doing what is within his human power. Like a normal man, a normal strategic commander. Even Aisha radiallahu anha, his wife, she used to be asked, how was the Messenger of Allah with you as a husband in your house? We want to know how he was. And she used to say, very simply, كَانَ يَسْنَعُ كَمَا تَصْنَعُ الرِّجَالِ. He used to do just whatever any other man would do. You know, Iroka Udalio used to patch up his own pot which he drank with. He used to sew his own clothing sometimes. He used to help us in the house sweeping. Like any other man does. Sometimes he'd read, he'd have his time, sleep, nap, eat. But when it came time for Salat, he went for it as if he didn't ask. He looked like any other man. Normal. Every Muslim, chill out. You can't be, chill out people. And have a personality, by the way. Muslims, have your personality. You realize that as I'm talking to you, I've got my own personality I'm showing. I'm not shy of it, right? Don't hold back, but obviously don't be rude or disrespectful. Have a personality. Laugh, smile, do all these things. Laugh, smile, hug, but I mean men with men, women with women, not you see a woman and smile and hug. No, yeah, within limits, inshallah. Unless she's your wife or your daughter or whatever. My brothers and sisters, then the Muslims were so rejoiced that this miracle is happening. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam thanked Allah and says, the wa'ad is for us, we're going to take it over. As they were going on their journey, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did another amazing thing. See, I love talking about the seerah because it's not really about the battle, it's about what happens in between, what happens in the way, it's what we're learning on the way. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, who of you has a nice voice? Nice voice. Singing voice. They said, Ya Rasulullah, it's Urwa, or I think his name was Urwa, or maybe. He says, chant. So he started singing, you know, verses of poetry. And his voice was amazing. It was beautiful. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to love beautiful voices. But he used to say, use the beautiful voices in something that helps you get close to Allah. So for example, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari, radiallahu anhu, he used to recite in the night prayers. And as the Prophet ﷺ was going to the masjid or going come, he used to hear him. He used to like going past his house to hear Abu Musa reciting Quran. And one day he came closer and he said, he kept listening and listening until he stopped reading. He said, لَقَدْ أُوتِيَ أَبَا مُوسَى مِزْمَالًا مِنْ مَزَامِيرِ أَلِي دَاوُدْ. Abu Musa has been given one of the beautiful flutes. He called it a flute. One of the beautiful flutes of the family of Prophet Dawood. They used to have amazing voices, Dawood alayhi salam. And he said, who of you has a beautiful voice to chant for us? Urwa or Umay, whatever his name was, he started chanting. And all of them, the rest of the Muslims started to chant with him. Wallahi, it was such in good sync. They were in good synchronized. The Sahabi wrote the story, says, it's in Bukhari, he says, the camels were seen to start to swerve from side to side to the tune. Now, I don't know if camels or animals, I think they have this effect. I've seen it before with my brother used to sell parrots and things. And you sing to them and they start moving up and down. You move from side to side. They move to rhythms, subhanAllah. Even babies do, right? People have cats or dogs. They find them moving to rhythms, right? The other day, I think I was singing to the fish. And they started moving all over the place. I think they didn't like the voice. I'm just scared. I'm joking. I didn't sing to the fish. They would have enjoyed themselves. My brothers and sisters, what happened next? The camel started to swerve from side to side. I know my jokes are cheesy. Wallah, I know. So they started to swerve from side to side. And on one of the camels, there were 10 women. Women had accompanied them. And they were sitting inside this camel. And this shows us that there's nothing wrong. A woman can hear, you know, a nice voice from a man, so long as it's something that is respectful. And what happened was that they almost fell off the camel. And the Prophet said, who is it that's reciting? They said, it's so-and-so. He said, he went up to him and said, Mahlam bil qawarir. And it's something very important here. It's so beautiful. He says, take it easy out of care for the fragile crystals. That's the Arabic statement he used. Now, you know, in Arabic, you always use metaphors. For when you want to lift and value something, you use metaphors. In English, it doesn't make too much sense. But in Arabic, mahlan bil qawari, take it easy on the pressure. In other words, on the precious women who are sitting on their camels. If men are stronger, they can hold themselves, but these women, they're having trouble. So just lower your voice so the camels don't swerve and dance too much. And subhanAllah, after he finished talking to him, the Prophet ﷺ said, Rahimahullah, may Allah have mercy on his soul. Umar radiallahu anhu hears him, he says, Ya Rasulullah, are you preparing us to say farewell to him already? It's as if you're telling us he's a shaheed. He said, that is the qadr of Allah. And he ended up being among the first shuhada, martyred, killed in this battle of Khaybar. Rasulullah ﷺ already knew. So this is a little something there. My brothers and sisters, they reached the fortress. The first fortress, was one of the most difficult. And the last fortress was the most difficult. They have names, but you don't need to know all the names. You can look it up, each one has a name. First fortress was the most difficult. Very high, very long, very big, lots of soldiers in there. And the Muslims laid siege there for about 10 days. They couldn't go in. Every day the Prophet ﷺ would give the flag to someone, one after the other, to try different maneuvers. And to equalize between the companions. 1 minute the flag is with this person, 1 minute. And you know what the flag is? The flag meant that everybody follows the flag. It had the control. So whoever carried the flag had the control of the army. Every day he's trying, and they can't enter the fortress. The Jews decide to stay inside and they started throwing arrows at them. One after the other. But the Muslims were not able to enter. It was a difficult, difficult fortress, but they were going to penetrate. And the lesson here is Muslims, do not give up. You're on a mission, you make an objective, you have a goal, you have a project that you want to do and it's worth it. You're going to find obstacles in your way. You're going to have to be patient, you're going to sweat, and you're going to have to try harder. Don't ever give up, always find different avenues. That's what the Prophet ﷺ was doing. He stuck his ground. And then one day, a slave of one of the Jews, he used to look after his flock, he comes out in secret and says, Ya Rasulullah, I want to embrace Islam. So he embraces Islam in secret, and he gives them secret information about the Jews inside. And he had some flock. Now, this is another good lesson here. He said, Ya Rasulullah, this is sheep for you, take them and eat them. You're at war. Good idea. Good idea. Rasulullah said, no. This is a trust. You're looking after it for your master. We are not allowed to take it. This is haram wealth for us. Take it back. You can't. SubhanAllah. Even is that what I could have taken? No. Trust is trust. Because like I told you, the bigger purpose, the bigger mission of the Prophet is not to kill and to invade and to take rights, but to call out of darkness into the light, from oppression into the vastness of justice and fairness. My brothers and sisters, he said, what can I do with the sheep? If I go back inside, they'll kill me. He said, let me. He read on them something, and the sheep, they watched him walk. They went all the way back into the fortress by themselves. And they stayed inside with the Jews. The Prophet ﷺ said, Alhamdulillah, the amanah has been returned. And the man fought with them. He embraced Islam after Fajr, sunrise. This servant, this slave, embraced Islam. The Prophet ﷺ freed him, of course. He embraced Islam after Fajr, not praying, because he embraced Islam after Fajr had gone. And he was killed before Dhuhr prayer. The Prophet ﷺ looked for him. And as he was burying him, the Prophet ﷺ closed his eyes. They said, Ya Rasulullah, what's going on? He said, whoever would like to look at a man who entered the highest of paradise without worshipping Allah once in his life, look at this man. Didn't he embrace Islam after Fajr? He couldn't make it to Dhuhr. He said, وَلَمْ يَسْجُدْ لِلَّهِ سَجْدًا. He never prostrated to Allah one sajda. Look at this man. He said, why did you close your eyes, Ya Rasulullah? He said, out of respect for his wives in paradise. He has two wives, I saw them, they were coming to take him. So I closed my eyes. That's something prophets only can do and say and see. And it's beyond us, subhanAllah. My brothers and sisters in Islam, therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at the amount of work that you're doing. Rasulullah said, Inna Allah la yanzuru ila suwarikum. Allah
counseled. لا ينظر إلى صوركم ولا إلى أجسامكم. It doesn't look at your bodies, how good they are, how nice they are. ولكن ينظر إلى قلوبكم وأعمالكم. He looks at your heart in one hadith, in another hadith, at your heart and at your actions. يعني your actions and your hearts have to be together, have to be in sync. Sincerity. This is what Allah looks at. You might donate $10. Another person donates $10. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts it from the $10 as if it was $1 million. He accepts it from the other guy as if it's just $10. Why? Maybe you've only got $100, the other guy's got $1 million. And you are doing it sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yours is worth more. Maybe the other person's doing it to show off. Isn't that correct? My brothers and sisters in Islam, and then they kept going. Then the Fajr, next Fajr, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, actually the night before, the last 10th night, Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, tomorrow the flag will be given to a man whom Allah and His Messenger love, and he loves Allah and His Messenger. And Allah will open the fortress, this fortress, on his hands. Umar radiallahu anhu stood up. We always hear his name coming up, and he's very blunt. He says, Wallahi, I never wished to lead, to be a leader, until that day when he said, a man will lead you tomorrow, carrying the raya, the flag, and Allah and His Messenger love, and he loves Allah and His Messenger. He says, I wanted to be that person. The Fajr time came, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked, where is Ali? Ali radiallahu anhu. They said, Ya Rasulullah, he's in his tent, he's very sick, he's got eye problems. He came to Ali and says, what's wrong? He says, Ya Rasulullah, I can barely see in front of me. He was injured. So Prophet ﷺ got some of his saliva and put it into his eyes. He read something and he was cured. And he gave him the flag. He said, Ya Ali, radiallahu anhu, you have the flag. Oh, what glory this was. All the Sahabas wished that they were Ali radiallahu anhu on that day. He was the one, Prophet ﷺ said, Allah and His Messenger love. Now obviously Allah loves all the messengers, all the companions. But when it comes out from the Prophet's mouth, like at that point, it just means so much, doesn't it? Ali radiallahu anhu is a very special man. No one can deny it. Among the elites, of the Sahabas. And so he took the flag. The Prophet ﷺ said to Ali, Ya Ali, go forward, lead the army, and do not turn back. Don't take a step backwards. Not one step. So Ali radiallahu anhu, as he's going forward, he reached about halfway and then he remembered. He went to ask the Prophet ﷺ a question. But he remembered the Prophet ﷺ also commanding him not to turn back. He goes, how am I going to ask him an important question, but without disobeying him? They learned from the battle of Uhud, you did not disobey the Prophet ﷺ. So he goes, I called out in front of everybody. Ya Rasulullah, so what do I do when we enter and they surrender? What do I do? Prophet ﷺ said, give them the option of embracing Islam. Leave them alone if they bear witness on His Messenger. Says, okay. Everybody heard it. And he kept marching forward. The Jews came out. And they started to look at this enormous. They're getting afraid. They're getting scared because the Muslims are not giving up. This time, the Jews came out. Actually, no, this time one of their leaders, one of their warriors, great warrior, his name was Marhab. This guy was equal to 1,000 soldiers. He came out and for the first time says, come to a duel, Ya Ali, let me fight you. Because that's demoralizing the companions, you know, the integrity and their bravery. If a warrior can beat one of their warriors, it's half the battle won. So he says, I'll fight you, Ya Ali, just me and you. He said, okay, I'll take you on. The man was a very strong man, Marhab, very, very obedient, one of the leaders and warriors. He comes in and starts to fight with Ali radiallahu anhu. They go, it was the biggest battle we've ever seen. They kept fighting for an hour. They went even into the trees, and we could see the branches and the trees being hit and branches cut off. We've never seen anyone fight like that. And finally, Ali radiallahu anhu were defeated. The Jews said, oh my God, this is one of our biggest warriors. Then another one comes out. Again, he defeats him. Can I take a step back for a minute? Okay. Before Ali radiallahu anhu, I forgot to say, Marhab came out to fight Muhammad ibn Aslam, another companion. And he
Muhammad ibn Aslam who beat Marhum. Then Ali radiallahu anhu was given, so retrack and all that fight in the forest with Muhammad ibn Aslam and this guy. And what happened? Ali radiallahu anhu the next day, and then another one came out to duel against him. And Ali radiallahu anhu immediately beat him. Then they sent out a third person, Ali radiallahu anhu, with a strike he beat. And so, what happened? The other Jews had come out, the door was open. All they want is the entrance. Some Jews came out and they were heading towards the Muslims. Ali radiallahu anhu suddenly stopped. And instead of going backwards, he went sideways, because Prophet ﷺ said he can't go back. He went sideways, and the Muslims thought, why is he retreating? Is he not going to the entrance of the door? What's going on? The Jews followed him towards the flag. And when they were far away, and there was a gap between the entrance of the door to the fort, he had prepared two flanks of armies. Soldiers here in these forests and in those bunch of trees. They came up from behind the Jews and entered the fortress. And that was it. The Muslims entered the fortress and took it over. Now I forgot to say, before they entered, the Prophet ﷺ gave the Jews three options before fighting them. He said to them, I give you a chance to enter Islam sincerely from your heart. Now obviously you can't enter Islam because of force. They had to be sincere. And they refused. They said, okay, if you're not going to enter Islam, become Muslim, you would be our brothers and sisters in Islam if you were to enter, and what's yours is ours, and what's ours is yours, and you stay in your lands. But they refused. Their arrogance and their glory took over. So then he said to them, okay, pay a jizya. Pay us a form of tax, which is 1 dinar per person per month. 1 dinar is like today saying $10 a month for a person, for each civilian. Nothing. And in exchange, we will protect you. You will be under the Islamic State protection. Anyone who attacks you, we fight them, we consider it jihad. And any of our people who fight you, they are put to death. So your rights are met. You'll be protected in the Islamic State. And they refused. So then they said, okay, well then it's war because you're not agreeing. And that's how it happened, brothers and sisters. When they entered the first fortress, you know what they saw? They saw artillery, advanced artillery like they had never seen before. Like really advanced, really big artillery. It's like saying today, F-11 fighter jets and missiles with uranium, I don't know what. That's what, compared to today, that's what it was. And the Prophet ﷺ, there was one Jew who came out who was scared. He said to him, Ya Muhammad, I want to remain a Jew, but I would like to talk to you. In our Torah, it says that you are going to take over Khaybar. We know that. So I'm just coming out preliminary, just look, you know, I'm betraying my people, but I want your protection, I won't fight you. For me and my family, will you give it to me? Prophet ﷺ said, yes, okay. And the man started giving the Prophet ﷺ information about the Jews. So this guy comes in, he's got the protection of the Prophet, and truly he did stay protected till the end. He says to him, what are all these artilleries for? What's all this preparation? I mean, people prepared it, were about to attack someone. And he said, Ya Rasul Muhammad, because he didn't become a Muslim, they had been prepared to attack you. They were coming to Medina because the Bani Nadir who escaped, they wanted it back. So they were preparing to come to you. Prophet ﷺ therefore knew, he was a very strong tactician, he knew that they were about to attack. So it was a preemptive strike. So he said, Alhamdulillah. They took all the artillery, and now they had big, massive artillery. They had the catapults, and they had those, I don't know, man, we shouldn't go back to Eurect when we studied humanities. You know those big ladders? They got wheels, and they're kind of covered, and soldiers stay in them, and they climb up over the walls with them. Anyone know what they're called? Anyway, those things. They used to call them dababat, like tanks, but not real tanks. Anyway, they used to have leather in front of it, and the Jews, whenever they saw this, they used to throw arrows at it. And obviously the leather would protect the Muslims, so the Jews started lighting up the arrows with fire. So the Prophet ﷺ said, wet the leather, make it wet with water. So it was a tactician, he's still using every power that a human can. So they took over the first fortress, then they went to the second fortress, my brothers and sisters, and the Muslims also took it over. Then the third fortress. The Muslims became very hungry. Ya Rasulullah, we're hungry. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you food soon.
were very starving. They were so starving that one day, a group of donkeys came past, domesticated donkeys, and some of the companions slaughtered it. They didn't know it was haram, and they ate it. He said, "What's this?" They said, "Ya Rasulullah, we're hungry, we saw the donkeys, we ate it." Prophet said, "This is haram food. Domesticated donkeys are haram." And he said, "As for wild donkeys," which is zebra in Arabic, call them wild donkeys, the zebra is halal to eat. This is where the hadith happened. Just to let you know where Prophet said, domesticated donkeys are haram to eat, but zebras are halal to eat. They managed.
So donkeys become haram that day in Khaybar? Or
yes, in Khaybar it became haram. No. Because you know, the Seerah, as Prophet is teaching them along the way, became haram there. As they entered the third fortress, before they entered the first third fortress, a big warrior from the Jews came out. His name was Yasir. Yasir. Don't worry, you can name Yasir if you like, but he knows his name was Yasir. He comes out. This guy was massive. Rasulullah looks at him and he goes, "Ma atwala." How tall is he? He was literally about 2.5 meters tall. Rasulullah looks at him, he's a very scary man, a big warrior. He says, "I want a jewel." Prophet looks around and goes, "Who wants to go and face him?" And then his cousin, Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, the Allah is also a very strong warrior, but not as tall as him. Pretty tall, but not as tall as him. Zubayr, I would say, would be as tall as one of the imams we have here, Egyptian imam, good friend of mine, very tall. But this Yasir is even taller than him. So Zubayr goes, "I'll face him, Ya Rasulullah." Now his mother, Safiya, the Prophet's uncle, auntie, she said, no, not my son. Rasulullah said, "Why not?" She said, "Ya Rasulullah, he'll kill my son. Look how big he is, a giant." Prophet said, "No, Az-Zubayr will kill him." Az-Zubayr goes, fights him a few little here and there. Within a few minutes, Az-Zubayr kills Yasir. Gone. This is Allah's victory happening. Why? Because they're obeying the Prophet. They're sticking together. They're one. Their hearts, they're sincere. They're not fighting for wealth. They're fighting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're in the right. There is a justifiable war. SubhanAllah. Allah's victory is there. They enter the third fortress, and in there was lots of food. The third fortress happened to be the one with the most food. Most food. The Muslims ate and drank, and there was gold and silver. Lots of gold, lots of silver. Here's another incident now. You ready for it? And there was lots of wine, alcohol. They used to love drinking alcohol. Now, there was a Sahaba by the name of Abdullah, companion of Abdullah. The problem with him was that he used to be an alcoholic before Islam. So he comes to help gather the wine and break it. He's supposed to spill it out and destroy it. What happened? The olden days came back. Yeah. Started drinking. So I can't. Alcohol. can't help himself. Sahabi, who made the pledge under the tree, one of the most elite, promised paradise. He drinks alcohol. Khalas, he was addicted in the past. He comes to the Prophet and the Prophet says, "What's this?" I couldn't help myself. So the whipping, usually the Sharia says 40 whips, light whips, just out of humiliation. The whipping hadn't come down in the Quran, so the Prophet, he took off his shoe and he started to hit him with the shoe. The Sahaba saw him hit him with the shoe, they all started to hit him with the shoe. It's more of a humiliation for him. Why? It's more of a gentle sort of, it's like what Lebo mothers do. You're 30 years old and you're going to move out. He throws the shoe at him. Anyway, what happened is this Sahabi Abdullah, as he was being hit with the shoe, obviously not much pain, Umar radiallahu comes up again. As I told you, Umar is quite funny. He's very blunt. He just says as it is. Where's his heart on his sleeve? He says, "Curse him, how bad he is. The messenger is here." And he goes and drinks alcohol. La'natullah. The Prophet stopped Umar and said, "La ya Umar, la taqul dhalik. Don't you dare say that. Wallah, I know that this man loves Allah and his messenger. I know that this man loves Allah and his messenger. Don't say anything bad about him. Don't judge him." You see, my brothers and sisters, you see, this is a problem in our community today. Among us Muslims, especially among us who sometimes we get religious very quickly, but we forget the wisdom. We go and judge people. Look at this person, look at her, look how she wears her hijab, look how he does his beard, look at her.
careful, my brothers and sisters. This is a lesson that Rasulullah ﷺ taught us. Ya Umar, don't say that. For Wallahi, I know that he loves Allah and his messenger. Yani, we don't judge people based on one or two sins or three sins. It's not his character trait. He happened to have an addiction before and then he drank alcohol. Sometimes people convert to Islam. They've still got some of their past that they're struggling with. And this is what mujahada is. Some people were religious before they come into the religion. They look at their family and they want to convert them overnight. And you forgot that your dad has been trying to wake you up for 30 years of your life for fajr. And you never woke up. He's always been praying. And now, after 2 months, you think you're a scholar. You want to tell your dad what to do. Take it easy, my brothers and sisters in Islam. Have some wisdom and don't judge people based on just outside appearances. Allah knows the hearts, my brothers and sisters. In the day of judgment, a scholar enters hellfire. A charitable person enters hellfire. And a mujahid enters hellfire. Why? Because they each did it for showing off. None of it will count. So my brothers and sisters in Islam, be gentle with your advice to the people and look at the action, not the person. Look at the action, not the person. Separate the individual from the act. Otherwise, if it wasn't Allah's mercy upon us, none of us will be secure and safe. Everyone has sins, everyone has faults. If only you knew my faults and I knew your faults and your faults and your faults. Nobody will trust anybody, no one will talk to anyone. So my brothers and sisters, have gentleness and mercy upon one another. We are here to advise and remember that Hidayah is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a beautiful moment that I want to talk about in this particular Khaybar treaty. My brothers and sisters in Islam, so they took fortress after fortress after fortress until they reached the last fortress, the fifth one. There were others, but this was the main one, the strongest fortress, the highest fortress. Without going into too much detail, how did they take it over? The leaders of that Jewish fortress gave up. But this is what they did. They went to the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, their leader, and he said, look, just forgive us. We'll pay the jizya, we'll pay you that tax thing that you talked about. That was a month ago. We'll pay you that tax. And let us keep our land and everything. Prophet ﷺ refused. He said, no. That was only applicable at the beginning of the battle. But now that you're about to fall, you come and tell me, let's do the tax. No, we don't fall for that trick. That's a trick. It's like Fir'aun. Musa went to him, sign after sign after sign after sign. In the end, when he's drowning, and all the signs are shown to him, and his nose is about to die, he tries to trick Allah. He says, Amantu, I believe in what Musa and his people believe in. That's not a true shahada. And Allah says, Al-ana wa qad asayta min qabl. What now? And after all the miracles and signs, too late. So there comes a time where it's too late. Fajizya is not applicable now. They said, don't be Rasulullah, please, you know, we surrender, we surrender, we surrender. So what did the Prophet do? He said, I will only change the terms. Yes, Allah does say, وَإِنْ جَنَحُوا بِالسَّلْمِ فَجْنَحْ لَهَا وَتَوَكَلَ Allah said, and if the enemy wants a truce, then you also respond and rely on Allah. But how do you respond? He said, I've got to change the conditions so that we're secure. You know, you're treacherous people. You've proven it. The condition is, you leave your homes and lands. Don't come back. Get out of here. Get out of Arabia. You do not take anything with you. And you show us where all your gold and silver is. Yes? And you do not help anyone against us ever again. And we enter, you get out. They said, okay, we agree. They signed the agreement. And then they went, as they were about to leave, the Jews got together and they said, listen, let's go and try and negotiate again. So they went back to the Prophet ﷺ and said, Ya Rasulullah, Muhammad, please. And the Prophet ﷺ said, what do you want now? He said, look, we know this land better than you. You're not going to be able to look after it. You know, leave us here. We'll farm. We'll crop for you. We'll do all the labor. You're in authority. You know, we won't own anything, but we'll work for you. And just give us half of the profit every year. That's a huge amount. Like, so we're talking about millions of dollars in today's currency. So the Prophet ﷺ thought about it. You know what? My sahabas, they don't know how to plow. They don't know how to farm. They don't know this land. Okay. So he agreed. He said, on one condition, the dominance is for the Muslims, and I have the right to ask you to command you to leave any time without any conditions, and you will have 50% of the produce every year. They said, we agree. He said, but if you hide any gold or silver, all of your people are put to death. Do you agree? They said, yes, we agree, because that is the command in our Torah, that if we break an agreement, by God's law, we have to be put to death. So they agreed not to hide anything. So they agreed to that, and the agreement went ahead. Then the leader, he started passing by this place, this rundown place. And remember that slave, the Jew who said, I want your protection? He said, Ya Muhammad, I saw him passing by that place, visiting it every time. Go and check it out. Prophet ﷺ goes, digs out the place. He goes to him, what's in there? He says, nothing. He says, is there anything? He goes, no, nothing. Any gold, any silver? He says, nothing. It belonged to another leader called Huyay ibn al-Akhtar. So Prophet ﷺ goes and digs. What does he find? He finds gold and silver. Come here. Didn't we agree that if there's any gold and silver, all the people are put to death? He said, yes, please, look, just take it easy on me. Just, you know, please forgive us and whatever. Leave the people alone. So the Prophet ﷺ looks at the Jews, women, children, and his mercy kicks in. Instead, he kills the leader and the person that was with him who helped him conceal the truth. After that, there was a woman by the name of Ummu Bishr. Bishr was a companion. He had become a Muslim. He was a Jew, became Muslim. And his mother was still a Jew. She heard about the news and she said, please invite the messenger of God to come, Muhammad to come. We want to make a feast for him to thank him, you know, for all the good, the mercy that he had upon us. So he went there and they all gathered and they said, Ya, O Muhammad, we betrayed you and you were truthful. We just want to hold a feast for you to celebrate and honor you. So Prophet ﷺ said, okay, that's good, thank you. And she said, what do you like? Which meat? And it was Prophet's favorite meat was the shoulder of the lamb. He goes, I like the shoulder of the lamb. So they went and got shoulders of lamb, cooked them in the best way, barbecued them, prepared them, and invited Prophet ﷺ and his companions to a big feast. Beautiful, romantic, nice, beautiful, isn't it? Prophet ﷺ comes, and with him was a bishop, which is his friend, companion, the son. So bishop eats and swallows, and Prophet ﷺ is eating and chewing. Then Prophet ﷺ notices that something's wrong with the meat. He notices a taste, and he feels numb. So he spits the meat out. He said, this meat has been poisoned. Bishop, he says, Ya Rasulullah, wallahi, when I swallowed it, I felt pain. But I saw you keep eating, so I thought maybe you could just keep going. He said, the food's been poisoned. They poisoned me. Okay. They went to Ummu Bishr, and he gathered the companions and said, was there poison in the food? They said, no. He said, will you? No. He said, will you lie to me? They said, no, we'll always tell you the truth. He said, okay, who's going to paradise and who will go to hell? They said, the Jews will go to hell first because of what we did, but then God will save us and you will stay in it forever. That's what their Torah says. He said, wallahi, the Muslims, if they go to hell, they'll be saved and you will stay in it forever. Then he asked them another question and they kind of twisted the truth. And then finally he said, okay, was there poison in the food? And they finally admitted, yes, we put poison in your food. He said, why? They said, because we thought, if you're a liar, you're not a messenger of God, then we'd have done away with you. And you won't misguide us. And if you are the messenger of God, then the poison might kill you. Look at this mastery, mashallah. Sounds smart, right? Sounds smart. It almost sounds, I keep saying that statement, sounds like all Muslims are terrorists, but not, what is it? All terrorists are Muslims. What is it? All Muslims are terrorists, but not all terrorists are Muslims. Is that how it goes? It sounds so stupid that I don't even know how it goes. Sounds smart, it's just hate speech and so on. This is the same thing. If you were not a messenger, you would have died. But if you're a messenger, you'll stay alive. So this is just a ridiculous manipulative statement. So Ummu Bishr, she said, forgive me and all that stuff. And Prophet ﷺ forgave her for himself. But Bishr died 2 days later from the poison. And Bishr is an honorable, he's got his value. And the law says whoever kills someone is put to death. That's the penalty in Islam. So they brought Ummu Bishr, his mother, and she was put to death. Al-Qisas. Murderers get killed, one for one. So then the deal stayed like that. And from the spoils of the war, they gave it out to the Muslims who fought with them.
And there was this woman, her name was Safiya. She was the daughter of one of the biggest leaders. His name was Huyayy ibn Akhtab. Big, she was beautiful. She became a widow afterwards, her husband died. She was intelligent, she was knowledgeable. She came to the Prophet ﷺ, she was one of the spoils of war. That's a tradition, that's how it is, universally. So the Prophet ﷺ looks at her and says, out of respect for your position that you hold with your people, I free you. You're free. In return, she said, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa annaka rasulullah. She converted to Islam. Prophet ﷺ was shocked, says, why? Suddenly like that, I made you convert to Islam. She said, when I was a child, my father and uncle met. And my uncle said to my father said to my uncle, Ahua Ahua? Is it really him as he is in the Torah? And my uncle said to him, he is exactly as he's described in the Torah. It is Muhammad, the Prophet, but he's from the Arabs. And my father said to him, Wallahi, even if he is, I'll be the first to disbelieve in him. And my uncle said the same. She goes, it stayed in my head all this time when I was a child. And now I could embrace Islam. And now came the opportunity. I believe that you are the messenger of God. She had no, she didn't have to. She was free. That shows you, my brothers and sisters, especially parents. What you say, even if you whisper it, you know, some parents, they act. But the children are hearing everything. Man, they've got 20-20. They can hear more than you. They can read lips. They can read lips. You know, babies, they say up to the age of about 4 or 5 years old, they can understand 4 times as many sounds as we do as adults. So don't fool yourself. What you do, your children copy. What you say, they'll remember forever. Forever. Anyway, she embraces Islam. The Prophet ﷺ becomes intrigued with her, such a valuable woman. He says, will you marry me? She said, yes, I'll marry you. So he marries her and she became the mother of the believers, the ex-Jew. Now his wives, Prophet's wives, especially Hafsa, they got jealous of him. So they started to look at him, she's beautiful, you know, she's knowledgeable and all that stuff. So one day they started saying, you know, every time they got annoyed of her, they say, hey, daughter of a Jew, you daughter of a Jew? And that's why I say to brothers, don't call each other Jew, oh, you're such a Jew. That's sometimes some kids, they go, you're such a Jew. We don't hate Jews. Even today we don't hate Jews. We are anti-Zionist. We are not anti-Jewish. Be careful, brothers and sisters. Wallahi, I have to say the truth. The majority of Jews of the world don't have anything against you. They don't. And we have lived with them for 1,400 years. After the Battle of Khaybar, this day, there was no animosity between us and the Jews until World War I. Until World War I. Nothing. But it was the Zionist movement that went into Palestine, took over Jerusalem by force and called themselves an Israeli state. They are the Zionists. And the Jews of the world go against them. We're not anti-Jew. We are anti-Zionist. So don't let those enemies try to make us fight. We don't. Anyway, this is to say you're the son of, you're the daughter of a Jew. So one day he comes in and finds her crying. He says, what's making you cry, Safiya? She said, oh, you know, your wives, the other, my co-wives, they're calling me sort of daughter of a Jew. You know, they're trying to denigrate her. So then he said to her, and this is how you deal with bullying. You don't go and say, where are they? Show me where they are. You know, imagine a father, 10-year-old son, he's getting bullied in class. I'll go with you now. You show me where these 10-year-old boys are. He goes and starts bashing them. No, you don't do that. Or talking to them. You teach your children and your students how to deal with bullies. So he equipped her. He said, yes, Safiya. So what? You go and tell them that your father is a prophet and your uncle is a prophet and you're married to a prophet. And none of them are. Who's her father? Her great-grandfather Harun, alayhi salam. He is the great-grandfather of her father, Harun, Prophet Harun. And her uncle, Musa, alayhi salam. And her husband, the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi salam. And truly, she went and said that to them from that day. They never called her that name ever again. Okay? SubhanAllah. That's the story of Safiya, radiyallahu anha. My brothers and sisters in Islam, one more thing happened, and I'll say it quickly before the Maghrib. A Bedouin suddenly came in when the battle was happening in Khaybar and he embraces Islam, a Bedouin man. And the Prophet ﷺ said, you will receive some of the spoils of the war. Here, take some of what we've already got. The Bedouin refused and he said, no, Ya Rasulullah, I don't want any of it. Because then why?
He said, I embraced Islam to fight for the sake of Allah with you, because I believe in you, so that an arrow from this enemy enters from here and comes out from here. SubhanAllah, strange man. He comes and fights with the Prophet ﷺ. Within a few couple of hours, Rasulullah ﷺ looks for him. He finds him dead. With what? An arrow coming in here where he pointed and coming out where he pointed. SubhanAllah. And the Prophet ﷺ looks at him and says a word that goes, Bakhin Bakh. An Arab statement. Amazing. Amazing, he said. A man enters paradise without a single worship in Islam. Oh Allah, I am witness for this man. So this is another incident that happened where the Sahaba said, each of us wish we were in the Bedouin's position. My brothers and sisters in Islam, next week inshallah, we will continue to talk about what happens next. The coming of Ja'far ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu from Abyssinia, and a very interesting story about that. And then inshallah, the opening of Mecca. Thank you for listening. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. I think it's the opening of Mecca or Hunayn first, so whichever. Thank you for listening. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad.